trustees, oh yeah, that's good.
Good evening, welcome to the Portsmouth Board of Adjustment meeting for May 19th, 2015. First order of business for the evening will be the approval of minutes for April 21st, 2015. Are there any comments or corrections to those minutes? Mr. Ayum?
Yes, thank you. On page three, at the very bottom of that page, last line, there's a sentence that starts off, Mr. Stazek replied that he understood why the changes were being made and agreed with them. I'd just like to clarify that it should read why the changes to the home were being made and agreed with them. In particular, that was talking about the home as opposed to the shed. And then further on page nine, about the middle of the page, the section on decision of the board, the main paragraph starts off with Mr. Rayum. Last sentence is the odd shape of the property made the use a reasonable one. What doesn't quite capture what I was trying to say, if it could be reworded as the odd shape of the property was a hardship and the proposed changes are reasonable. And that was it.
Any further comments or corrections? I'll just note page 11, the last paragraph. Chairman said that he would support it with a minor hesitation. The last sentence, the point I was trying to make was, I think I'd substitute the sentence, the house would become taller by raising the ridge as this project is not simply adding dormers. Just swap out that sentence. Any further comments or corrections to the minutes? A motion to approve.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
The minutes have been approved. Moving on to old business, we have case 4-2, petition of 233 Vaughn Street, LLC, property located at 233 Vaughn Street, assessor plan 124, lot 14. This is in the zoning district central, business A. They're looking to install a bathroom in space designated for mechanical equipment. This will require a variance from section 10.531 to allow a structure height of 59 feet 9 inches for the habitable space of the building where 50 feet is the maximum allowed. This petition was postponed from the April meeting. Mr. Mulligan will be recusing himself on this and Mr. Johnson will be sitting in. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Yes, Mr. Chair. My name is John Boson and I'm here to speak on behalf of the petition. Good evening, members of the board. I represent 233 Vaughn Street, LLC. We seek a variance from Article 5, Section 10.531 to permit installation of a rooftop toilet shower to go along with the previously approved rooftop pool. You will see this, we hope that you see this as a very reasonable and straightforward request because it won't change the appearance or the height of the building in any way. When this building was approved, Section 10.531 provided for an allowed structure of 50 feet with a permitted roof appurtenance of 10 feet. What this request involves is permission to take that roof appurtenance that was originally designed for mechanical space and install a bathroom in its place. Many of you may be familiar with this property. It's newly constructed mixed-use residential building with 9 residential condominium units. The building is now substantially complete, and it does include a small rooftop swimming pool for its unit owners. In January of this year, New Hampshire DES recommended that we provide an adjacent toilet and shower facility. You'll see in your packet there is a letter, I believe January 23rd, from New Hampshire DES. In that first paragraph, New Hampshire DES supports the request before you, and the third paragraph goes on to explain why it's important for those to have that shower bathroom facility. And for those of you that have a swimming pool, I'll spare you the details, but it's embedded in paragraph 3. Our zoning ordinance defines a roof appurtenance as a device or structure not designed for human occupancy attached to the roof of a building such as the mechanical equipment room in this case. The planning board has required us to seek this variance because a bathroom is considered habitable space where a mechanical room is not. Now, the key to our request, though, is that there'll be no change to the height or the appearance of the building, but the change does create habitable area, which exceeds the maximum building height allowed in the district, thus the variance is required. That being said, I do believe the applicant meets all the criteria necessary for the board to grant the requested variance. First, granting the variance will not be contrary to the spirit and intent of the ordinance, nor will it be contrary to the public interest. And the test here is whether or not the variance being granted would substantially alter the characteristics of the neighborhood or threaten the health, safety, and welfare of the public. In this case, if the variance is granted, there would be no change to the neighborhood, nor would any public health, safety, or welfare be threatened. This is a newly constructed mixed-use facility, building, which has already been extensively vetted out by the other land use boards prior to its construction. So any concerns relative to abutters and the public have already been vetted and taken into consideration. And since there'd be no exterior modifications involved in this request, the essential characteristics of the neighborhood won't change in any way. The relief requested is also very small. We're talking 51 square feet. Finally, the proposed toilet and shower room would not in any way threaten the public health, safety, and welfare. In fact, quite the opposite. The whole purpose of the relief requested is to improve public health, safety, and welfare by adopting the recommendations of New Hampshire DES. The next part of the variance test involves substantial justice. Whether or not substantial justice will be done by granting a variance requires the board to conduct a balancing test. If the hardship upon the owner applicant outweighs any benefit to the general public in denying the variance, then substantial justice would be done by granting the variance. And to that, I would submit that it's substantially just to allow a property owner reasonable use of his or her property. The proposed toilet shower room to be located in the space where originally was approved as mechanical equipment, that is not needed now, and that is the purpose of the request. But there's no visible change to the exterior of the building as a result of the request, so it would be unjust to deny the variance and impair the health, safety, and welfare of the property owner. Next part of the test involves surrounding property values, and it's our position that surrounding property and those in the vicinity will not be negatively affected in any way by this relief because there's no visible change to the property. Also, this is a very nice, newly constructed, state-of-the-art building that will, in fact, serve to enhance the property values of the neighborhood. Next, there are special conditions associated with the property which prevent the proper enjoyment of the property under the strict terms of the zoning ordinance and thus constitute unnecessary hardship. This property is unique. The building sits on an irregularly shaped lot and it's bound by the railroad tracks. It's the only property that we're aware of that has a rooftop swimming pool in the city of Portsmouth. So having a toilet and shower facility is a reasonable use that is desirable from a public health perspective. Lastly, there's no fair and substantial relationship between the purpose of the ordinance as it's applied to this particular property. The purpose of the limitations on structure height is presumably to prevent overcrowding and unusually tall buildings. And the relief that we're seeking doesn't compromise those goals at all. As I mentioned earlier, the building project is substantially complete. With a rooftop swimming pool, it's a common amenity for all unit owners, and the relief requested is very modest. The space itself has already been approved at its current height to store mechanical structures, which are just simply not necessary now. So instead of pipes being in there, there's going to be a toilet and a shower. So there's no fair and substantial relationship between the purpose of the building height requirement as it applies to this property. So for all those reasons, we do respectfully request that you grant the variance as advertised.
Thank you. Are there any questions from the board? Mr. LeMay?
I have two questions. One is, am I correct that you're not asking for any increase in height?
That's correct.
What's there?
No increase in height.
And there was no mechanical equipment in this area that's been displaced?
It's just been relocated to the other mechanical section.
All in the interior?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, Mr. Rayum?
Yes, thank you. There's two doors now to the mechanical room, and it also looks like a window. Are you adding a door and a window to this mechanical room that wasn't there before?
No, we're not.
Okay, so there's always two doors to the mechanical room and a window to that particular mechanical room?
Yes.
All right, so you're just taking advantage of that fact. My other question is one thing I didn't see in all the information you provided was something that showed us where the pool was relative to this bathroom. I didn't know if you could describe that. There's no like plan view that would indicate that.
Well, it's hard to see, but it is here. You should have a plan in front of you titled ADA Bath Facility.
Yep.
And the bottom drawing has a square box.
Sure.
And that square box is the roof appurtenant in question.
Yep.
Below that, you're going to see a very small sliver of blue.
That little sliver of blue, that's
it's your... not an Olympic-sized pool.
All right. Okay, thank you. I was just trying to get some idea.
Yeah, sure.
Any further questions from the board? Hearing none, thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? Anyone to for or against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request to allow some mechanical space to be converted to a bathroom.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to grant the variance as presented.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
All right. Your motion, please.
Sure. I think the facts are pretty straightforward here, so I'm just going to run right through the criteria to get things moving along. The variance will not be contrary to the public interest and will be in keeping with the spirit of the ordinance. In this case, basically, we're dealing with a structure that already exists and a building height that already exists. So the relief is really just a conversion of something that already is in existence. So it would be in keeping with the character of the building and in keeping with the character of the neighborhood. Substantial justice will be done. The hardship to the applicant would outweigh any perceived benefit to the public. In this case, the DES has required that they provide some sort of facility that such as the one that they presented. Therefore, they need to find a place to put it, and this appears to be the most logical one. The value of surrounding properties will not be diminished. Nobody should take note of the change to the building. Therefore, it wouldn't have any impact on property values one way or the other. And lastly, there would be an unnecessary hardship. There are unique conditions here that you have a structure that already exists, a building height that already exists, and this is essentially an infill within that. The proposed use is a reasonable one, and I think I've pretty much covered it. And there's no fair and substantial relationship between the general purpose of the ordinance here and the application of this property. For the reasons I've already stated, it's the height already exists, so they're not really asking for anything different than what is there, other than just the functional use of the space.
All right, thank you. Your second, please.
Yeah, I'll just touch on 2 points in particular. The public interest. This is kind of an unusual case in the sense that we actually have a statewide board here that has provided some information talking about the public interest here. We certainly wouldn't want the owners of million-dollar plus condos to suffer the heartache of a cryptosporidium infection. So within that, there's plenty of public interest in trying to ensure that this health code is kept up to where it needs to be, even though it's just a recommendation, but nonetheless, it is important. The other part is the hardship criteria. I struggled with that a little bit when I was thinking about this case, but I really do think that we have here, a lot that was bound to have a fairly large building upon it. Prime real estate location would be likely to be the first, as the applicant has pointed out, the first property to have a rooftop pool here in Portsmouth. So there's some unique aspects of this property here that are driving this occurrence of having the rooftop pool and the consequential need for the bathroom. And they, as the applicant has indicated, they're making no other changes to the property. Even the window and door are currently existing. So with that, I support the motion.
Thank you. Any further comment from the board? Hearing none, I will call for a vote. The motion is to grant. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Rayum?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
And the chair votes yes. Petition has been granted.
Thank you very much.
Moving on to new business, case 5-1, petition of Strawberry Bank, Inc., property located at 14 Hancock Street, assessor plan map 104, lot 7, in the zoning district, mixed residential office. They're looking to ask to keep up to 12 chickens on the property. This will require a variance from section 10.440, use number 17.20, to allow the keeping of farm animals in a district where it is not allowed. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Yes, my name is Larry Yurden. I'm CEO of Strawberry Bank. I live at 372 Court Street. Can I approach and distribute some more updated photographs?
Sure, if you just drop them off at the end, we'll slide them along. Thank you.
Strawberry Bank is seeking a variance relief from as Article 4, Section 10.440, User 1720, to install and manage a historical poultry exhibit. The mission of the exhibit is to enhance the museum visitors' understanding and appreciation of the historic Puddle Dock neighborhood and its residents, and to expand the museum's popular foodways and domestic industries program. The exhibit will be populated by a maximum of a dozen live chickens. All of them will be hens. The exhibit will be seasonal. There will be minimal amount of noise. Chicken manure will be incorporated into the compost that the museum's horticultural program manages as part of its extensive garden program. The poultry exhibit will be managed on a daily basis by members of the horticultural department who are experienced in raising and caring for chickens. We have a museum professional who is an authority on rare breeds of animals who's acting as our consultant for this. We do have a veterinarian who has agreed to consult as a consulting veterinarian. And previously, in my previous position at Hancock Shaker Village, I was administrator of a site that had a full-fledged farm, so have some experience there. In reference to the requirements for granting the variance relief, we believe they are satisfied. The granting of the requested variance relief will not result in the diminution of the value of surrounding properties. We believe the historical poultry project will have no effect on the value of surrounding properties, as the chickens will not be visible or heard from any of the surrounding city streets or neighboring homes. Requirement number two, granting the variance will not be contrary to the public interest. We believe the use of a small portion of Strawberry Bank's open space for historical poultry project will neither alter the essential character of the neighborhood or threaten the public health, safety, or welfare. Requirement number three, the granting of the requested relief will do a substantial justice. The loss of Strawberry Bank, loss to Strawberry Bank and the community of this historical exhibition, if not permitted, is not offset by any gain to the public that would result from prohibiting the housing of chickens. Number four, a requirement the granting of the variance will not be contrary to the spirit or intent of the ordinance. We believe the creation of the exhibition on Strawberry Bank campus will not be contrary to the spirit or the intent of the ordinance as spelled out. And number five, the literal enforcement of the provisions of the ordinance will result in an unnecessary hardship. The first question that has to be asked is whether there are special conditions about the property that distinguishes it from other properties in the area. The answer is an emphatic yes. Strawberry Bank is an outdoor living history museum that reproduces 300-year documented history of the Puddle Dock neighborhood. The proposed use of a small area of Strawberry Bank's campus for this exhibition is reasonable and beneficial to the community. Thank you.
Right. Are there any questions from the board, Mr. Rayum?
Yeah, I was just wondering, your description that was provided to us talks about the exhibit being seasonal, April through December. So I wonder if you can tell me if the chickens still remain in the property from December through the following April, or are there no chickens during that time?
There are no chickens during that time.
Okay, so December, they are no longer with us.
That's a good
Christmas dinner or something.
That's, yeah.
And then the information you just passed out, the little shed.
Yes.
That's shown there. Is that intended to become the chicken coop, or are you going to be erecting a different?
That is the chicken coop.
Okay.
We're fortunate to have in the archive photographs of this chicken. It actually replicates what was there historically. Interestingly enough, at least from my standpoint, it was shared by two or three different families, and they raised their chickens and a couple turkeys there as well.
Okay, thank you.
Any further questions from the board? Mr. Mulligan?
Just one point of clarification. I think you did say no roosters, just
no answer. Roosters, right.
That's all I want.
Mr. LeMay?
Just a little, I got kind of a background question. Museum's been operating there for many years. Why now with chickens?
I think you'd have to say that about any of the programs that we keep adding to what we do. It's just a clarification. I think it's an elaboration of telling the story of what's going on at Strawberry Bank. We're going to add a gallery on maritime history in another 6 months. There hasn't been one there since we opened, so it's just an additional program.
Okay. Any further questions? In the off season, can we expect these chickens to do any skating exhibitions?
No,
or anything
we have
like that?
Forbidden them to have ice skates.
Oh, okay.
Yes, we're afraid they'll fall on the ice and break a leg.
All right, so. Just want to clarify that too.
We don't want them clucking around.
All right. Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? Anyone to speak to, for, against? I guess I could note we did get one letter in opposition from Charles Griffin. He essentially objects to the chickens. It seems to be more so in the sense, I can't read the whole letter, about the number of variances and special exceptions the Strawberry Bank has received over the years. He does, however, suggest a stipulation that I don't know if the applicant's open to. He says, he asked that we attach the following stipulation, that every Saturday night, a member of the Board of Trustees must chop off the head of a chicken, pluck its feathers, and otherwise prepare it to be cooked and served on Sunday, all in public, thereby enabling visitors to truly experience and better understand what it is like to raise chickens. So, something for your consideration. So, any further comments from the board? Or any questions? Anyone else two, for, against? Seeing no one rise, close the public comment session and entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we approve as presented and advertised with the stipulation that there be no more than 12 chickens and no roosters.
Okay. Is there a second?
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
Your motion, please.
Yes, thank you. Just to address, I mean, the letter writer did have a sincere intent in talking about the number of variances that the Strawberry Bank has received from this board, both fairly recently and in the distant past. And I find it somewhat concerning a little bit as well, but I do think there are some reasons for it. First of all, obviously, it's a museum located in a residential neighborhood, so by the nature of its existence and its business and what it's trying to do, it's naturally going to have different requirements than some of the surrounding properties might have in order to fulfill its mission both as a museum and as a cultural resource for the city of Portsmouth. Also, again, it is essentially zoned in a essentially residential type area. Obviously, it's got a little bit more than that to it, but it's a very big property in an area where there's lots of very, very small properties. So again, that also drives some unique characteristics that this property has that some of the other properties around it simply would not have. And I think that applies here in terms of this request for a chicken coop. We've had a few of those come before us, and I think we've granted most of them. And in particular, this one reminds me a lot of the one that we had in the neighborhood near Maplewood Avenue, just off the Route 1 bypass, where it's a property that's much, much larger than many of the properties that are surrounding it. You know, a chicken coop that would be right up against a neighbor's house would be something that might be more objectionable. Here, I think where the applicant has put the chicken coop is essentially, you couldn't put it much more in the middle of their property, maybe a little bit more, but to one side, but not by much. I mean, it's pretty much smack dab in the middle of their property, unlikely to affect any of their neighbors. It would simply be something that would be part of exhibits for people coming in to visit it with a minimum of objectionable qualities for the surrounding neighbors. So with that, the criteria of the variance will not be contrary to the public interest. Again, that's a balancing test between what's the positive aspects of this for the public and the museum in terms of providing its benefits to the public versus any concerns about surrounding abutters or changes to the characteristic of the neighborhood. Again, with the fact that this is very centrally located, would be essentially invisible to the neighbors and to the general public, would only be able to be essentially observed by the by people who are visiting the museum, I think it passes that test. Spirit of the ordinance will be observed. Again, the real concern here is having people with large numbers of farm animals, including chickens, located in very residential neighborhoods, which the vast majority of Portsmouth qualifies as. Again, some of the unique characteristics here is this is a very large property, and we're talking about a relatively small number of relatively innocuous animals in terms of chickens without the rooster, which we've made a stipulation here, which should keep the overall nature of this farm type experience be minimalized, and I think in keeping with the spirit of the ordinance. Substantial justice will be done that will allow the museum to continue what they perceive as their mission for providing information to visitors to their area. It does provide, there is a historical context for it, as the applicant has indicated, and there's really no overriding balance for the surrounding neighbors that would say that is not worthwhile. Value of surrounding properties will not be diminished. Again, the properties are already around this museum, and this is just adding to the characteristics of that because it's centrally located, nothing objectionable that would affect their property values. And then the hardship criteria, again, this is a very large property within a very area with lots of much smaller properties. Everything's being done here to keep the effect on those other properties minimalized. So the hardship here is they are unique in being a museum, large property, and what they're proposing to do is relatively reasonable. So therefore, they meet that criteria as well. With that, I recommend approval.
Thank you. Your second, please.
I would agree with everything Mr. Ayoum said, and just add that if you look at the basic activity that's being requested, it's a pretty benign use of the property. So that goes to the first two criteria in my mind. And then is it consistent with what the mission of the museum is? And of course it is, because if it's to replicate what was there in past years, dozens of years, it is bringing back an old use that was there for apparently a long time. And then we're always concerned about the effect upon the neighbors. In this case, if in three directions, the house and the facility will be buffered by other buildings, and then the most direct one, where there isn't any that much buffering over to Marcy Street, is not occupied by residential structures anyway. So I think that the chances of it having an adverse effect on the on any of the neighbors is small to none. So I think it easily passes the five criteria, and most importantly, it's consistent with the mission, and which goes to the observe the spirit of the ordinance to my mind, and it will be an historically accurate addition in both in terms of the size of it apparently and the location. So I think it passes all the criteria.
Thank you. Any further comment from the board? I'll just quickly comment on Charlie Griffin's letter, which I read just the end of, where he had a kind of tongue-in-cheek comment on a stipulation. But the part of the meat of his letter was kind of hinting that because this is the Strawberry Bank, that the board tends to bow down to them and give them the variances and special exceptions. And I don't find that necessarily to be true. I think we take each case individually with a fresh set of eyes. I don't think anyone really gets any special treatment. I think if he asked for one rooster, because that would be historically correct, I don't think the board would have stomached that. If he said they wanted to have six cows, I don't think the board would stomach that. So I do think the board does want to protect the neighbors, uphold the zoning ordinance, and I don't necessarily feel the Strawberry Bank gets any special treatment just because who they are. I think we're supportive of the Strawberry Bank on a personal level, but hopefully I don't think we all bring it up here when we sit down and vote. That said, I will call for a vote. The motion is to grant with the stipulation no more than 12 chickens and no roosters. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Ayoum?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
Mr. Mulligan?
Yes.
The chair votes yes. Petition has been granted. Moving on to case 5-2, petition of John and Joan Burnap. Property located at 50 South School Street, unit number 2, assessor plan map 101, lot 60-2. This is in the zoning district, General Residence B. They're looking to replace an existing 18-by-12-foot deck in the same footprint. This will require a variance from Section 10.321 to allow a lawful, non-conforming structure to be reconstructed or structurally altered without conforming to the requirements of the ordinance, and variances from Section 10.521 to allow a rear yard setback of 11 feet where 25 is required, and 43.5% building coverage where 30% is the maximum allowed. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
We're John and Joan Burnett. We moved here to Portsmouth, New Hampshire just in October. Purchased a unit in the Haven Condominium School Building. And at the time that we were looking to make the purchase, we had a full and complete inspection done by Michael Wilhelm Inspections. I did a full book of every aspect of the property. And probably the biggest item was that he looked at the deck and said that it was totally unsafe for use. He said that the small two by four supports underneath and one beam where there should be three beams. It's attached to the building itself across the back of our unit. And he said there's really actually no support under that. It's laying sort of on a ledge attached to the building. We assume it's been there for a long, long time. We have double doors on the back of our unit, glass doors that go out to that deck, and it's built into a full window structure. The windows are the old school windows built in the 1800s that go, you know, almost halfway up the of the room to the ceiling, and that's built right into that window structure. So we know it's been there a long, long time. His recommendation was that we don't just repair it, that we do replace it for all safety reasons. In addition to the supports not being sufficient, all the railings that go around the deck are totally rotting. You can probably just kick and push them through. So we feel it's very unsafe to use. A hardship is it is pre-existing. I guess our hardship is that it's in close proximity to the back fence of the building, even though it's been there a long, long time. And also that the building itself is built on a not much larger piece of property. It's been there for so long. So our limitations are tight in all aspects. We do have a letter of recommendation from our condominium association that totally approved it. We did just get approval 2 weeks ago from HDC, and they agreed that it should be replaced and not just repaired and approved, because one of the members actually went and did a site visit, looked at it, and he suggested to the whole board that night that it be replaced and use materials that are resistant to rot, you know, instead of just using wood. He said it was an instance that would be a good idea because it's in a damp, it's under a tree, it's in a behind the building in a dark sort of area, and said that would be preferable. So that was all approved 2 weeks ago. We feel a real hardship as we have four grandchildren. That was the reason we moved up here, to be close to our children, grandchildren. And here we have this deck on the back, and the children come over and look through the doors, and we've had to keep it locked and won't let them go out there because we don't want them falling through the deck. It is 7 feet off the ground, and there is no access from the outside. We only can get to the deck through the interior of the building. And we'd like to replace it rather than just try and patch it or repair it.
All right. Are there any questions from the board? Mr. Rayum?
Yes, thank you. First of all, thank you very much for providing us with a handwritten letter. That's pretty rare. I didn't think anybody actually handwrote like multi-page letters anymore.
I don't have a computer right now. We moved and haven't bought a new one.
So that was very impressive. I guess one of the things that concerned me, and you sort of touched on it a little bit, was I wasn't sure if you had any records of exactly when this deck was built. And my concern comes from your inspection report, which really talks about the deck being built of, you know, amateur quality construction and workmanship. And I was just wondering, what we have in our staff report talks to a previous variance that was granted when the school was broken up into the six condominium units that are now there. But there's no real mention of these variances. Now, admittedly, the zoning ordinance could have changed since 1979 that now require a, you know, more of a setback than might have been required back then. But I was curious if you had anything that would indicate that this was definitely legitimately put up with a building permit or something along those lines.
Well, just because of those double doors that go to the exterior, I mean, we assume that there was, it looks like something's been there for a long, long time. Mm-hmm. The town itself, I had them look when we came to get a site map, and they couldn't find any backup materials on anything, and our condo association couldn't find any record of any of it as well. I mean, he looked through all the legal documents we have for the building. The president of our association couldn't find anything in particular on it either. So we're okay. just going blind.
No, thank you. I appreciate your honesty on that. And then my other question is, are you the only unit that has a deck, or do
we
any
are,
of the other?
We are the only unit. We're on the first. There's two on the first floor, and the two run from front to back, so it's like a flat, like a English flat that goes from the front of the building to the back. And we are the only one, and no one has any other, I mean, we don't, there are no windows even that look out on the first floor onto that deck, so it's all very private back there. Mm-hmm. We just have adjacent neighbors to the rear, and they have decks as well.
Okay, thank you.
Any further questions from the board? Hearing none, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? And 2-4 against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request to replace an existing deck, same footprint, which requires setback and lot coverage relief.
Mr. Chair, I'd move to approve as presented and advertised.
All right. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Your motion, please.
Thank you. All right. This is, I think, fairly straightforward, where the applicant is seeking to replace and rebuild within the existing footprint of a what appears to be a long-time pre-existing non-conforming structure. I think the applicant has made a strong showing that the way the property is, or the way their unit within the property is configured, it appears that there's exterior doors that open up onto this deck, and it would really be a hardship to the applicant if they were not able to use those doors for anything useful, like obtaining access to a porch or balcony, which is what they're looking for here and what they've already got. So just going through the variance criteria, granting the variance would not be contrary to the public interest, nor would it be contrary to the spirit of the ordinance. What's being proposed is rebuilding within the same footprint as already exists. The project requires HDC approval, so I think that ensures that the character of the neighborhood will not be substantially altered, nor will the health, safety, and welfare of the public be threatened in any way. Granting the variance would result in substantial justice. Here, I don't believe there's any gain to the public, which would offset the loss to the applicant if this request were denied. The deck itself that is being replaced is in the rear of the property. It doesn't have any visible access to School Street. So the public at large will not be affected in any way by this non-conforming structure being rebuilt on site. The closest affected neighbor to the rear hasn't voiced any opposition. The other members of the condominium association are in favor of the property, and they're really the only ones affected. I don't see how substantial justice would be at all advanced if we denied this application. Granting the variance will not diminish the values of surrounding properties. Again, very similarly, this will not be visible to anyone on School Street. The affected, most affected neighbors and members of the condominium association who really have skin in the game haven't given us any indication that they're opposed to this in any way. So granting the variance will not diminish values of the surrounding properties. And from the pictures we have, it appears that it's something of a dilapidated situation, so this will likely enhance the values of the surrounding property. And finally, the unnecessary hardship requirement. Here there are special conditions of the property that distinguish it from others in the vicinity. This is a very large property for this neighborhood that's been broken up into a condominium ownership. The deck itself that's at issue here already is an existing nonconformity. The applicant's representation is that their unit has double doors to accommodate the use and enjoyment of a deck. It's the only property within the condominium that has that configuration. Really, the only other property owners affected are the other condo owners, who arguably are losing some minimal common area in the rear of the building. But even that's probably debatable. So I think there are special conditions of this property that distinguish it from others in the area. I don't think there's a fair and substantial relationship between the purpose of the setback and the lot coverage ordinance as it applies to this property, since this is just rebuilding in place an existing nonconformance. And the use is obviously reasonable. It's reasonable for people who live in a condominium unit with double doors that open out onto what is almost a second floor to have some place to go with it. And I think a deck is the right thing. So for all those reasons, we should approve this as presented and advertised.
Thank you. Your second, please.
I agree with that thorough motion and have nothing to add.
Any further comment from the board? I think it's a good point made that the fact that some we see projects that go through the HTC do help with the criteria, that doesn't change the essential character of the neighborhood. So I think that was a good point made. That said, the motion is to grant. I would call for a vote. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Rayum?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
Mr. Mulligan?
Yes.
The chair votes yes. Petition has been granted. Good luck. Moving on to case 5-3, petition of Richard and Jennifer Maths, property located at 69 Sunset Road, assessor plan map 153, lot 15, in the zoning district single residence B, looking to replace an existing shed with an 8-foot by 10-foot structure in the same location. This will require a variance from section 10.521. to allow 25.9% building coverage, where 20% is the maximum allowed. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Hi, thank you. Yep, I'm here to speak. My name is Rich Mathis. I'm the owner of the property, my wife and I. And we're looking to replace our existing shed with a slightly larger shed. The basic premise of our request is that our current shed is kind of falling apart, and while we want to replace it with our growing family, we have two small children, and the amount of like outdoor equipment and things that we seem to be putting in our shed has grown, and the shed's kind of bursting at the seams as it is now. So we'd like a slightly larger shed to be able to put those things into. Relative to the issues that we feel is not contrary to public interest, because our current shed is looking pretty sorry right now, and we'd like it to look a lot nicer. The increase in size is pretty modest, and we think it's reflective of our neighborhood. Our shed is pretty well hidden. We have a garage that abuts directly on the property line. Our neighbor's garage is literally on our property line, and that's what our garage, where our shed sits behind. So there's no way that neighbor would see it. And that's the closest neighbor to it. There's also a very large fence by our other neighbor, who is the lot behind us, the Hilsons. And that particular fence really hides the shed entirely. And then our other neighbor on the left side of us really wouldn't see the shed anyways, because it's really far away from their property. We've spoken to all of our neighbors, and they're all very welcoming of our plan, so they don't really object to it in any way. We feel that the spirit of the ordinance is being observed. We're trying to maintain all of our setbacks. We're trying to not really encroach on anyone's property. We're just trying to make a little extra room for our family and the things that our kids need. We feel it will also only enhance, not diminish, the value of our surrounding homes. Substantial justice would be done if this is approved, because it would allow us to have improved storage, which means that we'll have less things sitting outside of our shed, where a lot of the stuff that we have now sits, because it can't fit in our shed, which I'm sure our neighbors really don't enjoy looking at from day to day if they can see it. The literal enforcement of the ordinance would result in unnecessary hardship because it just wouldn't allow us to have the quality of life that we want, and I don't think that outweighs any injustice done by the large, slightly larger shed. We're really only looking to increase the shed by 4 feet in one direction. So that's kind of our case, and we did talk to all our neighbors, and they were very supportive. So again, I thank you for the board's time.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions from the board? Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? 2-4 against. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request to rebuild a slightly larger shed requiring some lot coverage relief. Entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion.
Mr. LeMay. Approve. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, your motion, please.
I'll just go through these requirements since this is a pretty straightforward situation here. First, the variance is not contrary to the public interest and the spirit of the ordinance is observed. I would say this is not going to change the neighborhood substantially. We have the advantage here that this property sits on a hill and it is well shielded from the neighbors. I don't think any of the neighbors can see much, if any, of this shed. Substantial justice is done. This is small. There's a great benefit to the applicant, and there's no harm to the general public or other individuals, particularly abutters. The values of surrounding properties are not diminished. I would say that this has probably no effect on one way or the other on property values in the area. And literal enforcement of the ordinance would result in unnecessary hardship. I think that's true because nothing would be gained in terms of public benefit in terms of, you know, density, light and air, all the appropriate reasons for this. And so I guess that's all I have to say.
Mm-hmm. Your second, please.
I agree with Mr. LeMay's points and have nothing else to add.
Any further comment from the board? I think it's considering where it's situated up against the garage, a fence in the corner there, the elevation changes, it's set on the property pretty well, and I don't see any adverse impact at all on anybody's. That said, I'll call for a vote. The motion is to grant. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Rayum?
Yes.
Durbin?
Yes.
Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
Mulligan?
Yes.
The chair votes yes. Petition has been granted. Moving on to case 5-4, petition of Stephen Brady and David Schmoyer, hope I said that right. Property located at 51 Richards Avenue, Assessor Plan Map 128, Lot 4, the Zoning District General Residence A. They're looking to enclose an existing 9-foot 8-inch by 18.5-foot deck. This will require a variance from Section 10.321. to allow a lawful non-conforming structure to be extended, reconstructed, or structurally altered without conforming to the requirements of the ordinance, and a variance from Section 10.521 to allow a 6-foot right side yard setback where 10 feet is required. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. I am Arilda Dench, and I've put together this variance application together with David Schmoyer and Stephen Brady of 51 Richards Avenue, and I am here presenting it for them tonight. The Schmoyer-Brady property, with a home built in 1819, is at the very edge of the historic district. It is an undersized lot of about 5,009 square feet in general residence A, where the minimum lot requirement is 7,500. They currently cover, I came up with about 41% of their lot, where the allowed coverage is 25%. Also, their home encroaches on the 10-foot side setback on the right-hand side because their home is sort of historically located tight to one side. So they're 5 feet from the property line there. And as you can see on sheet one, there's an existing deck on the rear of the house that sits about 6 feet from the side property line. We would like to enclose that deck and make it into a screen porch. So we were asking to expand a non-conforming use. As you can also see on sheet one, the home of their neighbor to the right at 69 Richards Avenue is a fair distance away, and they're the only neighbor that will be able to see the screen porch. Behind the Schmoyer-Brady residence, there is a sports field beside the middle school, and across the street there is an apartment building. Their neighbor on the left side won't be able to see the porch at all because of a bump out in their building. David and Stephen have spoken to their neighbors on both their right and left side, and neither of them is opposed to this proposal. The main motivation for creating the screen porch is to make their backyard deck usable. As you can see on sheet 3 in the upper left-hand picture, there's a huge tree that towers over the house and neighborhood. It's more than twice the height of the house. It's very healthy, a magnificent tree, and they would like to keep this tree. And what happens is it rains down a constant shower of natural debris on the deck and is really a nuisance and makes it pretty unusable anytime they would like to go out there. The owners think this is a magnificent tree. They don't a great asset to the property and neighborhood, and they don't want to cut it down. So a screen porch would protect the deck from the debris and make it possible for them to enjoy their backyard. On sheet 4, you can see the tree's tight proximity to the existing deck. This is a very historic neighborhood, and so out of consideration of that, we have created an historically sensitive design for the screen porch, which you can see on sheets 6 and 7. As far as the criteria goes, the variance will not be contrary to the public interest, and the spirit of the ordinance will be observed. The screen porch will be an enhancement to the house and not a detriment to anyone else. It will be built on top of an existing deck, so the overall lot coverage, while not non-conforming, will still not increase. And the screen porch will only be visible from one neighbor who agrees with the design. It will also be partly hidden from the street in front and sports field to the rear by existing fencing and shrubbery. And the design of the porch is in keeping with the historic neighborhood. And then substantial justice will be done. No public interest will be violated by granting the variance for the above-mentioned reasons. Also, the noise levels should remain the same, as the current use of the backyard area will not change, and the size of the backyard area will not change. And then values of surrounding property will not be diminished. The screen porch will be an enhancement to the property and neighborhood with the historically sensitive yet modest design, and we feel it will not adversely affect any surrounding properties due to the low visibility. And then literal enforcement of the provisions of the ordinance would result in an unnecessary hardship. We feel that the historic small size of the lot and placement of the home tight to the right property boundary creates one hardship condition for the proposed screen porch. And then the magnificent tree, which should not be cut down, creates a second unusual hardship condition of excessive debris on the existing deck. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions from the board? Or could you just please, just for the record, restate your name and address, please?
My name is Arilda Dench, and I've put the proposal together for David Schmoyer and Stephen Brady of 51 Richards Avenue.
Okay.
Right. Do you need my address? Or?
No, that's fine. Thank you. Are there any questions from the board? Nope, I guess you did a good job. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? Anyone 2, 4, or against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request to enclose an existing porch, which requires a side yard relief. Entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I would move approval as advertised and presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
All right. Your motion, please.
This is a small lot with a limited potential, but what they're proposing to do is basically an infill project, which will have little or no effect upon anybody else's project, the neighbors who are pretty darn close by with such narrow lots. So with respect to, and they only need one, they need one variance, and the footprint, as I understand it, is to remain the same. So it's an infill project that's building upwards. So with respect to the criteria, granting the variance would not be contrary to the public interest, and granting the variance would observe the spirit of the ordinance. In both cases, I think there's a clear case can be made that there is no adverse effect upon anybody else. It is in the public interest to allow people to upgrade their properties and make it more useful for them, provided it doesn't hurt the neighbors. And in this case, I think it will only enhance this house and by reflection, the adjacent properties. And the spirit of the ordinance, again, is always to allow people or encourage people to upgrade their properties and make it more useful for them and future owners. Thirdly, granting the variance would do substantial justice. There's no overriding public interest that would argue that this, for some reason, should be disapproved. Therefore, the tip goes to the property owner. And granting the variance would not diminish the values of surrounding properties. As I said, this is an upgrade of a modest nature near the center of the property. So the effect, if any, upon surrounding properties is probably slightly positive, certainly not negative. And in the unnecessary hardship test, I guess you could say that there is no adverse effect on the general public, and that the specific application of the position of the property and the proposed use is certainly a reasonable one. And lastly, owing to the special conditions, and I guess the special conditions in this case would be the compact size of the lot, which limits, you might want to put a giant addition on it, but it's probably not going to work, and that's not what they're asking for. They're asking for a modest proposal to upgrade a part of their lot that's central and will do nothing but enhance this property and, as I said, possibly the adjacent property as well. So I think it passes all the criteria.
Thank you. Your second, please.
Yeah, I agree with Mr. Parent's comments. Just to touch on a couple of aspects, the spirit of the ordinance, really what we're looking for here is the light and air of the surrounding properties. What the applicant is proposing is a small one, essentially one-story addition that is quite some distance from the next neighboring house. And I think that also touches really on the hardship criteria that is unique about this property is it backs up to a municipal open lot on one side, and then the other nearest property neighbor really happens to be their house has shifted quite a ways over on the far side of the property. So there are some unique aspects to this property where there's the light and air considerations are really almost non-existent. So with that, I support the motion.
Thank you. Any further comment from the board? Hearing none, I would call for a vote. Motion is to grant. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Rayum?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Carrot?
Yes.
LeMay?
Yes.
Mulligan?
Yes.
The chair votes yes. Petition has been granted. Moving on to case 5-5, petition of Gerald R. Dolores A. and Gerald R. Jr. Irrevocable Trust. Property located at 174 Leslie Drive. Assessor plan map 209, lot 57. In the zoning district, single residence B. They're looking to construct a 15-foot by 22-foot attached garage. This will require variances from section 10.521 to allow a 5.5-foot right side yard setback where 10 feet is required, and 21.8% building coverage where 20% is the maximum allowed. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Good evening. My name is Dolores Brown. I've resided at 174 Leslie Drive in Portsmouth for 51 years. I come before the planning board to seek a variance in order to add one small single car garage to my family home. The side lot setback in my neighborhood is 10 feet. Currently, there are 21 feet from the southwest end of my ranch home to the lot line. I would like to add a single stall garage comprised of 15 feet width, thereby reducing the side setback to 5 feet 6 inches. All homes on Leslie Drive except one are ranch homes. Many homes have attached garages and carports. Many homes extend into the 10-foot setback, either by original design or by variances granted by the City of Portsmouth since the homes were initially built. Granting my request for a variance would not be out of character for the neighborhood and would not threaten public health, safety, or welfare. I'm 83 years old, was widowed 3 years ago, and live alone in my home. In the last 2 years, I have had total hip replacement surgery and spine surgery for removal of a tumor. Cleaning off ice and snow from my car is extremely difficult, if not impossible, for me. To have a garage attached to my home would allow me to remain living in my home and ease some of the burden throughout the winter. The benefit to me would greatly outweigh any perceivable harm to the public or other individuals. Were the side setback of 10 feet be strictly enforced on my lot, that would allow only 11 feet for me to add the garage. Having a garage so small would not be feasible for me to access open car doors, and entering through a small, undersized garage door would be dangerous trying to get in and out and avoid hitting the garage on the sides of the door opening. To deny me a variance when others in my neighborhood have been granted variances and been allowed to add a garage or extend well into the side setback would be unfair. The garage would add value to my home and therefore add tax revenue to the city. The added value would enhance the value of the homes in my neighborhood. And I thank you for your consideration.
Thank you. Any questions from the board?
Yeah.
Mr. Mulligan?
I've got a question. Ma'am, the photos and the drawings that you provided show that there's what appears to be about a 4 foot bump out with a screen door on it attached to the side of the house that you're proposing to put the garage on.
Right.
Can you tell us what that, the purpose of that, for, is that an addition that was placed?
No, that was on the original home. It's the entrance. If I go to the left where that back door is, it go into my kitchen, mm-hmm. and the basement stairs go down through that small addition.
Okay. All right, so that's not living space, so
no.
to speak. Okay.
No, it's just a hallway and an entrance to the basement.
And a landing for the basement.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Any further questions from the board? Hearing none, thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition? Anyone two, four, against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request to build a one-stall garage requiring some setback and lot coverage relief.
Mr. Chairman, I would move to approve the request as presented and advertised.
Okay, thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Your motion, please.
Yes, thank you. First of all, I hope that if I manage to live to be the age of 83, I look half as good as you. So I appreciate you coming before us. Taking a look in general at what the request is here, a 15-foot by 22-foot garage, I think, is a pretty modest request here. If you look at typical garage, single-car garage sizes, yeah, maybe you could shave a foot off of it if you really wanted to squeeze down a little bit. I mean, you can find 12-foot garages, but as the applicant has pointed out, those tend to be very narrow and pretty confining. A 22-foot length, which is pretty common for single-car garage, and the 15-foot width is pretty reasonable. As the applicant has also indicated, with this 4-foot bump out, there's really not an opportunity there to use up any of that space and bring the garage any closer to the main portion of the house. That's a access point to the basement. So with all that, I do believe that what's being asked for here is reasonable. So going through the criteria, variance will not be contrary to the public interest. I think the applicant has indicated, in a quick spin around the neighborhood, would indicate that many of the homes that are here have garages on them that were either look like they were add-ons or potentially part of the original the building. And in many of the cases, as the applicant has pointed out, those tend to be fairly close to property lines, including both of the neighbors, direct abutters, I think, appear to fall into that category as well. So I think the case here that this would be a change to the characteristics of the neighborhood. It would, in fact, be very much in keeping with the neighborhood. Spirit of the ordinance would be observed. Again, we're primarily concerned with light and air, and there is some impingement here upon the neighboring properties, but it's not terribly bad and not unlike what is, you know, already sort of being done to this property, really, by some of its neighbors, especially on the side that is closest here. So realistically, and we have not heard, you know, any particular negative opinions from any of the neighbors that would indicated they are fearful that their light and air would be affected. So I think that it is in keeping with the spirit of the ordinance. Substantial justice would be done. Again, this would allow, as the applicant has indicated, her to have a warm place to store her vehicle that's free from the harsh winter effects of snow and ice. Would make it much easier for her to be able to access her vehicle and continue to live in her home. So with that, the applicant's needs are certainly greater than what any public interest that would indicate that we should not allow this to happen. Value surrounding properties would not be diminished. Overall, this addition would probably add to surrounding property values, would probably add to the value of this home, and consequently the surrounding property values. There's nothing here that's being requested for. It's a modest addition that would potentially affect those values negatively. And then the special conditions of this property is, like many others in the neighborhood, it is on a relatively, because it's a sort of a ranch house, they tend to be wider, take up more land area, and it's very typical for this neighborhood. When the neighborhood was designed, this was a typical layout where you would have in this case, a 70-foot cross front property line, and the house would take up a good portion of that. And then when you add on a garage, you're essentially bringing it right up to the edges of the property. So there are some unique characteristics here that would be driving that. Is just the properties relative to what the zoning would require. And then the use is a reasonable one. Again, what's being proposed here for garage size is really consistent with the neighborhood and consistent with what the applicant is requesting for a modest single car garage. So with that, I recommend approval.
Thank you. Your second, please.
I agree with everything that's just been said, and I have nothing further to add.
Any further comment from the board? I'll just comment just to expand on the criteria not to change the essential character of the neighborhood. What is she's proposing is very consistent with what is found in that neighborhood, and I don't see any way that this, again, would change the essential character of the neighborhood of Leslie Drive. That said, I'll call for a vote. The motion is to grant. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Rayum?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
Yes.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
Mr. Mulligan?
Yes.
Chair votes yes. Petition has been granted. Moving on to the final petition of the evening, case 5-6, petition of James and Elizabeth Hewitt, property located at 726 Middle Road, Assessor Plan Map 232, Lot 47. This is in the Zoning District Single Residence B. They're looking to reconstruct a 20-foot by 30-foot barn in an existing footprint. This will require a variance from Section 521. To allow a left side yard setback of 3 feet where 10 feet is required. Is there anyone here to speak to this petition?
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Chair. Good evening, members of the board. My name is Scott Hogan. I'm a land use attorney from Lee, New Hampshire. Here with Jim and Liza Hewitt, here in the audience with me. The Hewitts purchased their property at 726 Middle Road in June of last year. At the time of that purchase, there was an existing 20 by 30 foot barn structure that had been left to dilapidate over the course of several years. When they purchased the property, it was in quite a state of disrepair. The walls and roof were all coming down a bit at a time. So when they purchased the property, they soon after began the process of removing the old barn debris, renovating the existing residential structure. So they're proposing now to build a new barn in the same footprint as the old barn. And I see, as the photographs show, there's a 20 by 30 foot foundation from the old barn. The Hewitts believe the provenance of the old barn to be probably around 1912, as there's a deed reference from that time. And that comes from, there is a 24 foot wide easement that runs parallel to the property line that we're talking about the setback being from. And so it's kind of a unique situation in that when you go out there is this 24 foot wide easement. There's a paved driveway in the easement that comes and services the front of the barn. So the 3 foot setback to the property line is in addition to a 24-foot easement that would prohibit the construction of any structures within that corridor. So in essence, there's 27 feet of space in which there can't be any structures. And I think as you saw from some of the other exhibits that were submitted with the application, it's in an area that is fairly far removed from any of the residential structures. It's actually quite a nice wooded setting where the barn stood for all of those decades. So the proposal is to rebuild in place the barn where it existed before. And I think you can see from the photographs that were provided, if the barn were going to be centered, if you will, the property itself is a 50-foot wide lot as it goes to the rear there into the woods. There's a substantial foundation hole, if you will, for where the barn is. So relocating the barn to another location more centered in the middle of the lot would require substantial fill and excavation, the removal of the existing foundation, the relocation of the foundation in a new area. It would also require the construction of a new driveway to access the barn, new pavement, etc. And so the barn where it's located right now, as it has been located for decades, really is an appropriate spot for the reconstruction of it. And the plans that the Hewitts submitted, I think we would all agree it's a aesthetically pleasing structure on the same footprint as the old barn used to be. And again, here it's unique for me in that having this 24-foot easement in essence gives you substantially more than the 10-foot setback that would be required under the ordinance itself. So in terms of any issues of light or air or access for emergency vehicles, all of those are fully accommodated. So with that said, I'll just go through the five variance criteria. Will not be contrary to the public interest. And here, and I think this is the hallmark for all of these, and the fact of the 24-foot easement as a no-build additional setback, if you will, not contrary to the public interest or injurious to public rights of others, and not unduly or in a marked degree conflict with the ordinance, so it might violate the objectives. Here, the objectives of the setback ordinance specifically, as I said, I think are met even more so than what the ordinance requires, just due to the actual existence of this 24-foot perpetual driveway easement that runs the length of the property. And the easement actually runs beyond the location of the barn. I think you can see in the exhibits that were submitted, it actually extends through to the back of the property, substantially past the historic location of the barn itself. Consistent with the spirit of the ordinance, again, here we're actually providing 27 feet of distance between there and, in essence, the other side of the easement, in which no other structure can be built. The proximity of the historic location of the barn to any other residential structures is such that it wouldn't have any interference with any the use of anyone else's property in any of those ways. So I think it is certainly consistent with the spirit of the setback ordinance. And any loss to the individual here on substantial justice that's not outweighed by a gain to the general public. Having a functional barn, and this would just be serviced with electrical service, there would be no water service to the barn. So having a functional barn that could provide parking, storage of equipment, et cetera, is really quite an amenity to this particular piece of property. And again, no impact to the general public in that respect. So I think the balancing test on that one is also fairly obvious. Value of surrounding property will not be diminished. Along with the variance application, there was a letter submitted from a realtor expressing her opinion, and I think this one as well. Given the investment that would be made, the improvement that would be made to the property by investing in restoring this historic structure, is consistent with the opinion of the realtor here, which was that adding a barn with parking and storage would significantly add to the homeowner's value, along with enhancing neighborhood property views and value by having such an added feature. An amenity of this kind is very difficult to find in a downtown residential neighborhood and would be an added value to the neighborhood. So I think in terms of any effects on surrounding property, if there is an effect, it would be to increase those values. And this one, again, in terms of hardship, owing to special conditions of the property that distinguish it from others in the area, the existence of this 24-foot wide easement certainly is a special condition of this property that, by an order of magnitude, increases, in essence, the setback that exists. It's an easement, so it is in perpetuity. And the fact of having the existing barn foundation in place, clearly, I believe, is also a special condition of the property as well. And when you look at the area that's the 27 feet that's accomplished by the 3-foot setback as well as the 24-foot wide easement, I think on that measure, there is no fair and substantial relationship that exists between the general purpose of the setback ordinance and the specific application to this property. I think this one is custom made, if you will, and in fact the barn was there for decades. And having this kind of an amenity and this kind of an accessory building for a residence like this is, I think, objectively a reasonable use. So unless there are, oh, and I'm sorry, there was this afternoon, there was a neighbor who I see emailed to the city. This is Randy Tyler, and I was asked to read this to the board. Hello, my name is Randy Tyler. I live at 740 Middle Road. I'm a direct abutter of Jim Hewitt at 726 Middle Road. My wife and I will not be able to attend tonight's meeting, but I want you to be aware that we fully support Jim and Liz's petition to rebuild their barn using the same footprint, and we do not protest their petition.
Any questions from the board? Mr. Rayum?
Yes, thank you. I just want to clarify and make sure I fully understand this. I believe as you've drawn on the copy of the tax map here, I just want to make sure the easement, in fact, runs across both the residential property, lot 46, and a portion of the Chase Home property, lot 45. It covers both properties.
Yes, that's right.
Okay. And I'm not sure if you said it or not, but do you know when the barn was torn down? I know we indicated it was probably put up in 1912.
Yeah, and I think torn down might not be exactly accurate because by everyone's understanding, it was just left to deteriorate and was not given any maintenance. Yeah. So my understanding from the Hewitts is it has been over the course of perhaps as long as 20 years or so that it was just left to deteriorate. One wall would come down. It would just slowly fell into its own pile, if you will.
Okay, so when was like the debris finally removed? Was it like 5 years ago, 10 years ago?
No, the Hewitts just bought the property in June of 2014, and they were the ones that actually removed the debris themselves.
Okay, and then is the intent to try and reuse this existing foundation, or simply the hole that's associated with the foundation and create a whole new foundation for this new barn?
I think right now the intent is to use to whatever extent they can, mm-hmm. And that's gonna, I think, be determined specifically by their contractor's recommendations in that regard, but it is fairly intact, as I think you can see from some of the photographs.
Yeah, some better than others. Okay, thank you.
Mr. LeMay?
Yeah, could you elaborate on the intended use of this? It seems like a substantial commitment to something that's so far out behind the house, and I haven't, you know, I'm always anticipating what variance comes next.
I believe my understanding now, and Jim can correct me if I'm wrong, but it is potentially just for parking, storage of equipment, and that's, you know, just as a accessory outbuilding barn. No living space.
I can see that's what it would be used for. That's what you believe the plan is?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Further questions from the board? Hearing none. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else to speak in favor of the petition?
Um,
Good evening. My name is Chris Blausch, and I reside at 768 Middle Road. And I simply wanted to come by this evening and just voice my approval of the project and support of the project. I had an opportunity to walk around the site with the Hewitts, and I can see where the value would be and having a barn in this location. And while I don't directly abut the property at my property, there are sections of my property where I can see sort of through the lawns and the backyards and see where the barn will be. And I have no objection to the project. I think it would bring value to the neighborhood.
Thank you.
And echo the sentiments of the previous email that was read as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else to speak in favor of the petition? Anyone to speak in opposition?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and the board. My name is Kyle Griffin. I'm an attorney with Keenan McDonald here in Portsmouth, and I represent Mr. 70, who is the direct abutter to this project. If I may approach the board with some photographs that my client took of the existing foundation, as well as a letter from the realtor and a memorandum of opposition.
Yep. Start those at the end. We'll pass them along.
Mr. 70 is the owner of 710 Middle Road, and he is the direct abutter to the Hewitts resident, and he opposes the granting of this variance. Mr. 70 purchased his property back in 1999. The barn as it stood at that point was dilapidated. It was in bad condition. In 2011, the barn did eventually collapse. A lot of the debris and remnants of the barn ended up falling on Mr. 70's property because of how close it's located to the property line. The only remaining portion of the barn is what we would call a crumbling foundation that is exhibited in the pictures that we provided to the board. Our first argument here is that there's no hardship that exists for the Hewitts here, as they're looking to build within 3 feet of the property line with the setback is 10 foot. Don't believe that the easement that runs through there is relevant. That property is still owned by Mr. 70, and there's no real exception to the zoning ordinance just because there is an easement that runs past where this proposed barn would be built. The Hewitts have enough space on their property, which is a 50 foot wide property, to build this existing barn within the zoning ordinance, within the setbacks. It'd have, you know, 15 feet on each side of their property. The email that was put forth today by the other abutter is not really directly affected by this construction of the barn, as it's not on his side of the property. I'm allowing the Hewitts to construct this barn so close to Mr. 70's property would not be in keeping in with the spirit of the ordinance. The 10-foot setback ordinance provides for a buffer for privacy for residential properties and the structures that are built on them. By allowing this construction of the barn within 2.5 feet, we're setting ourselves up again for another chance that if anything were to occur to this barn, it could, you know, land on Mr. 70's property, it could become an encroachment, it could become a trespass. We provided a letter from a realtor today that we do feel that the construction of this barn would be a diminution of the property value to Mr. 70. With such a small setback, there's a chance of encroachment and maintenance and trespass, and this would have adversely affected the marketability of his property. There's no positive benefit to the public by the construction of this barn. The only proposed benefit here is to the Hewitts, and the construction of this barn in no way, as we feel, promotes substantial justice. There would be, if the Hewitts were to build their barn within the setbacks on the property, they would obviously be able to use the fill from that foundation to fill in this foundation if there was ever a concern about that. And we believe that they wouldn't need to construct a new driveway, as coming within the setbacks here, the existing driveway and easement would be sufficient to use that barn, as well as to get the construction vehicles down there for that barn. And Mr. 70 would also like to speak to the board on his behalf.
First, are there any questions from the board while the attorney is here?
Yeah, I actually have a question. Do you have any understanding of what the purpose of that 20-foot, what a 24-foot easement is and why it runs the entire length of the applicant's property?
Well, I know it was a right of pass, and if I may speak with my client briefly, I think he has a little bit more information on when it was recorded and what the purpose is.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, anything's got to be in the microphone so we can have it recorded.
It was recorded in 1911 for the passage of...
For no purpose other than the passage of vehicles, animals, and persons on foot.
And this has existed at the property, you know, since that date.
And who is that, what property is that meant to benefit?
726.
Which is the applicant's property.
Any idea why it runs all the way to the end of the applicant's property then?
Because I do believe at that point in time, the owner of 726 was building his barn in 1911.
Okay.
Hence the animals,
yeah.
Specifically allowed.
Right, but the apparently the easement area extends beyond your property all along the 435 feet of the applicant's property back to the property owned by the Chase home. And I'm just trying to wrap my head around what the purpose of that easement is and who that's intended to benefit.
Yeah, I have no knowledge of other than what is in my deed. And it's, as I say, it's not an easement, it's a 24-foot right to pass for vehicles, animals, and persons on foot with a revocation clause.
Are there any other questions for myself?
You have an opinion about the significance of the revocation clause he just discussed?
It has been a long-standing...
If you could just speak in the microphone, please.
Oh, I'm sorry. It has been a long-standing issue, and it's something that I have never pursued. I think I have enough evidence of just negligence and abandoned vehicles, and I have complained to the city a number of times about abandoned vehicles, non-inspected vehicles, debris, that type of thing. So I think that I probably could have the right of passage revoked, but I'm not a vindictive person, so I have not gone that route. I have tried to get along with the owners of 726 Middle Road. But I do have documentation. I have photos way back to 1999. But it's not something that really I'm so inclined to pursue.
All right. I just have one more question for you, sir. The applicant provided us with a diagram that shows that the proposed that the nearest corner of the proposed barn, should it be rebuilt on that foundation, would be about 125 feet from the nearest corner of your residential structure. Do you think that's about accurate?
125 feet? I'm not so sure about that.
Okay.
Let me reference my lot here, but I don't know if it's quite that much. Now, what I do want to mention to the board is, you know, Kyle has addressed the technicalities of granting a zoning, granting this appeal. What I want you people to understand is what I have had to endure over the last 5 years. This barn collapsed in January of 2011. Not a piece at a time, the whole roof collapsed in, the walls bowed out, and 90 days after it collapsed, I filed a complaint with the city, and I told Jason Page, you know, this is a public hazard. Can the city do something to force the owners of 27726 Middle Road to remove this debris from my property? And I was told no. I waited another year, 2012. I filed another complaint. with Jason Page, once again was told the same thing. There is no ordinance on the books to allow Portsmouth to mandate someone to remove a collapsed building. I once again complained in 2014, and Jason and Rick came out, and once again, I got the same story. For 5 years, I drove into my driveway, and I was presented with a pile of rubble. It devalued my property. It didn't allow me to enjoy my property as I should. It affected the marketability of my property. And to me, this is exactly why setbacks are in place today. And I implore you not to allow such a situation to perpetuate in the future, not to allow a building to be built that close to the property line so that some future owner of my property would have to endure the same thing for however long it could be, because there's nothing on the books to force someone to maintain their properties. And that, to me, is what a setback is all about. It provides me some sort of protection from the exact situation that I've had to endure for the last 5 years.
Thank you. Any further questions from the board? Mr. Parrott.
No problem. Yes, sir. You've lived in that neighborhood for quite a while, apparently. And from your knowledge and looking at the ground, is there anything physical that you're aware of that caused the barn to be built close to the property line as it is, as opposed to being more centered?
Absolutely not. If you look at the existing foundation, the barn is built on a hill, and the hill is not just that close to my property line, it exists for the entire 50-foot width of the property of 726. It's a convenience to build it that close to my property line. There would be minimal excavation if they moved it over and they were able to conform to the 10-foot setback.
What a convenience in what fashion, do you mean?
They could just use the existing hole, I guess. But there would be minimal excavation because, as I say, it's built on a hill, and the hill exists for the whole 50-foot width of
their
lot.
Yeah. So there's no outcroppings of ledge or other anything else.
Nope.
Towards the center of the, so there's nothing off. It was built where it is for some reason, you know, obviously that was a conscious choice. I'm just curious if it's anything obvious as to why that choice was made.
I'm guessing it was built there because it would be easy to get the building materials closer to the property line. And, you know, we're thinking 1911, and it's a big rock foundation, so I don't think, you know, they had heavy equipment back then. I'm guessing, you know, horse and buggy, I don't know what they'd used. But you know, I'm guessing they did it because the easement, they wanted it to be built closer to the easement for, as a matter of fact, I think there's a reference in the deed regarding movement of stone or something for the barn. But that's what I'm guessing. I'm guessing it's so close to the property line because back then they wanted it as close as possible to that rite of passage so they could move their building materials in.
Okay, but there's nothing else that's it's obvious by looking at the property.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
It's built on a hill. It could be moved over 10 feet, built on the same hill. It would have the same elevation.
Okay, so do I understand correctly that you're not opposed to the structure, it's just the location?
I'm after the last 5 years and looking at pile of rubble at the end of my driveway, I absolutely am opposed to the location.
Was that under, when that collapsed, am I understanding correctly, that was under a different ownership?
It was.
Okay, so it's irrelevant what the new people have no connection to the old.
Well,
former owners, is that correct?
But an appeal, it goes with the property. It doesn't go with the owners.
Okay.
So the same situation could exist under any owner.
Well, it could, of course, yes. Okay, thank you.
Any further questions from the board?
I have a question.
Mr. Durbin?
Do you have any knowledge about when the pavement went in that goes over the easement area?
I'm glad you asked about that, because I do not. I bought it paved, but you should also know that the owners of 726 Middle Road do not do any maintenance on the driveway. I plow it, I maintain it, I pay the expenses for the driveway.
And when did you purchase your property?
1999. January 1999, to be exact.
How has the easement area been used since you purchased the property, or to your knowledge over time?
The prior owner, I'm going to try to be diplomatic. The prior owner used it for parking, but extensive parking. At one point in time, we had 11 unregistered commercial vehicles parked along the side of the property. There's always been at least one unregistered vehicle on the property. And we've called to complain about that, too. But
okay, thank you.
All right. Any further questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Board.
Anyone else 2-4 against? Would you like a rebuttal?
Thank you. If I could just briefly respond to a couple of points. We just heard from counsel that their opinion that there's no hardship and that the easement is not relevant. The easement is certainly a special condition of this property that distinguishes it from others. So it is absolutely relevant. Having spoken to many variance applications and seeing the various things that have been the bases for the granting of variances, like old trees that people don't want to remove, configuration of the lot, ledge, etc. The fact of this easement being there and providing 24 feet of a no-build area certainly is relevant to the hardship criteria. And in terms of the concern, and I hear that from the abutter in terms of the setting up a chance for the building, the new barn, to similarly some decades in the future collapse perhaps or be damaged and land on his property. And the concerns that were expressed around that. I just spoke to Jim, and Jim would certainly be willing to offer a condition, and the board certainly has the authority to condition the grant of this variance, and the condition could certainly be a specific agreement that if the barn were to collapse, that it would be removed. And that certainly would be outside of the city bringing some sort of enforcement action if that's been a problem in the past. But these landowners haven't been the ones that have had abandoned vehicles, and these are the landowners who, as soon as they purchased the property, immediately began to clean up the dilapidated barn, renovate the home, clean up the property in a general fashion, and they are certainly willing to offer a condition to this board that if some similar condition existed with this barn in the future, that the variance would be conditioned upon an absolute obligation for them to remove any material if it were to trespass or affect the neighboring property in any way. As to the right-of-way is an easement. I've looked at the deed myself, and it is in perpetuity. My understanding is the reason that it extends throughout the property was since the time of the easement being put into place, those two properties were subdivided. Jim believes that in the olden days, it was used to pass animals, etc., through the entirety of the property, but since that time, the property has been subdivided. I was curious about that myself, because if you go out there and take a look at where the barn is, there's no physical demarcation of the easement as it runs through the property, and it is kind of counterintuitive to understand why in this day and age it exists. But the practical original purpose, as we understand it, was to pass animals and people and vehicles all the way throughout the remainder of the property. As to the 125 feet and the other specific linear distances that were represented in the variance application, Jim was the one that made those measurements himself. Jim is also a licensed New Hampshire engineer, so I just wanted to note that to the board. And Jim also was just telling me that he does believe that the location of the barn is because there is ledge in the area between the barn and the middle of the property. And that is most likely why it's in the location that it's been since 1912 or so. So I just wanted to offer those comments to the board. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Just one question.
Mr. Mulligan?
There was a representation or a comment that the right-of-way is revocable. Is that not the case based on your understanding?
Well, there is, the deed does have a revocation clause, and as these things always work, the only way that it could be in fact revoked was a property owner would have to initiate a petition to quiet title or a declaratory judgment action, and the only way that it would in essence be revoked is if a court determined that it had been abandoned, that it had been used contrary to the terms of the easement. But it isn't just by someone proclaiming in fact that they believe those are the circumstances.
But it's not a license that's revocable at the grantor's.
No, absolutely not. It is an absolutely deeded easement.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.
Any further questions? All right. Thank you. Anyone else two, four, against? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. We have a request to rebuild a barn structure requiring a 3-foot side setback where 10 feet is required. Obviously, there's a lot of history to this structure, to the easement. I think the previous owner, excuse the pun, dug a hole for these clients that they're trying to dig out of too. The way they misuse the easement, the way they misuse the barn structure. So I can understand and appreciate the concerns of the abutter. My thought is probably either way this is going to get built, whether it's 10 feet or 3 feet. I'm just trying to sense the adverse impact of this barn being from me to that microphone closer to the property line, how that's going to be an adverse impact on the abutter, considering this structure was built and standing for well over 100 years till it finally cave in on itself. I think it's also important to note that within the planning department and the city council itself, there's talk about creating an ordinance to govern dilapidated structures and to be able to enforce the repair or removal of structures and not allow what happened to this barn to happen in the future. So that's definitely on the radar screen of the planning department and the council to address the issue of structures that are allowed to fall in on themselves. So I feel, that concern itself is being addressed and will become part of our zoning ordinance, whether it takes a year or so, but I think it will be. So again, I think for me, the issue to grapple with is 3 feet a reasonable location for this, considering the location of the existing foundation and how the property's always been used and how the structure's always been located. Again, I do feel sure they can probably move it over and meet the requirements without an ordinance, but again, it's that whole outweigh in the benefit to the applicant versus the harm to the general public. So that said, I can open it up to further discussion or if someone's ready to make a motion.
Well, I'd like to discuss the condition of this foundation a little bit, or the apparent condition. It looks like it's pretty much ready to collapse the way it is. Obviously, it's possible, or it appears to be possible, based on what you can see in the picture here, to move this thing 7 feet, or to construct a new building 7 feet away. I think the question, the hardship on the applicant, is not so much the location, whether it's 7 feet in one direction or the other, but whether or not they can salvage this foundation, and whether or not denying the variance and causing them then to have to take this down and move it is a justifiable hardship. To me, it's a close balance between those two issues here. The neighbor not wanting it right on the line, even though there is a easement in effect, mm-hmm. and the probability that they're going to start working on this and say, "Oh, we got to knock it down and make a new one anyway."
Obviously, we don't have any documentation that the existing foundation has been surveyed and can support the load that a barn would put on that, but I'd have to say from the photographs, I would be pretty reluctant to put a major investment on top of that.
Right.
I mean, I suppose you could get your rebar and encase it with concrete on the inside and get that look on the outside. That's a great deal of expense, but, you know, if that's the look they want. But I think to think you're going to go out there and start building, throwing some wood on this foundation is a real stretch.
Right.
Further comments, or someone like to jump in with the motion? So the night was going way too smooth.
I know. I was figuring
way too smooth.
I was figuring chickens at Strawberry Bank, or heights of buildings, or the little old ladies with garages have actually worked out to be pretty good tonight. So
careful.
I'll comment, Mr. Chairman. I guess I'm in the same dilemma as everyone else. I mean, I think this is a real real tight tipping balance. I can certainly share the abutters' frustration with what went on in prior years. I know something like that happened to me with the apparent abuse by the previous owner. Would probably infuriate me, especially over the course of years, and build up in a strong resentment to having you know, anything like that encroaching my property. I mean, if only the barn were another, say, 30 feet further down the property, it would, you know, have fallen on the Chase Homes property as opposed to the residential abutter, and we probably may not have as many issues as what we have now, but unfortunately that's not the case here. So I can definitely respect that request to try and say move it back, and I'm also dubious that foundation looks like it's going to be very much usable, and you know, there has been some representation that there might be ledge somewhere out there, but again, ledge is something you can get around as an expense, certainly associated with it, but it is something you can get around. But at the same point in time, I do believe that the barn that's being proposed here is quite a distance from the neighbor's actual residence, or anything else that's on that property right now. And, you know, realistically, things dilapidating and falling down, my experience at any rate, are relatively rare. And I know certainly if you happen to be the unlucky soul that has has that property right next to you that is the one that's in disrepair, it would be pretty infuriating. But to expect that to happen necessarily again with this property, with this barn, at some undetermined point in the future, I mean, certainly it sounds like the previous barn lasted at least, you know, maybe 80 some odd years of relative neglect, presumably especially with Portsmouth now, with property values and the types of people who are purchasing properties. I mean, most of one has a strong interest in keeping their property well maintained. There are obviously always exceptions. So, you know, is that strong enough to make us, you know, force this owner to move the barn over? I'm not entirely sure. So yeah, I'm on the fence on this one. There's good arguments on both directions.
And I think, too, if we were, say, this was in the historic district, you know, the HDC might take a really strong position that, you know, to have historical correctness and recreation, that it should absolutely stay in the same location, whether sight lines or that's how the farm would always be developed or the property would be used. So this isn't in the HDC, but, you know, it's part of the character and the spirit of the ordinance is to maintain part of our architectural heritage. That's not an easy one.
Mr. Chairman, I think if there was something other than speculation about ledge, in other words, if they looked at moving it and discovered there was actually ledge and there was a real problem and a real reason why this is where it is for structural reasons, that would be new information that could justify a rehearing.
Right.
I think they could try to make that. I mean, like Mr. Rames said, if there's ledge, it's not the end of the world to get rid of some of that. Right. And I'm just looking at the site plan, and just to the right of the barn, it looks like there's a mature tree noted. And obviously, if we slid the barn over to make that setback, we'd probably lose that tree. Now, should that be the tipping point? I'm not saying it is, but, you know, there's...
Looks like there's lots of trees to me.
Yeah, they do. I'm curious why they selected certain trees to note on the site plan is, I'm assuming those are the more mature ones.
Mm-hmm. I'd also note that in the fairly recent past, we had the Subaru dealership where they were arguing that the utility corridor should be, considered when they wanted to, cite a use that would otherwise not be available within a residential setback, and we kind of roundly rebuked that. So I don't think this is necessarily apples to apples, but the existence of the easement creating an extra buffer over and above the setback, I don't think that, I'm not going to say it's irrelevant, but I don't think it drives the analysis quite as strongly as the applicant hopes.
I agree with that. I'm just trying to see the adverse impact on the abutter, considering the distance.
I think
the adverse impact is, what if it collapses again? And that's a hard one for me to.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I mean, the abutter is obviously very frustrated over the historical misuse of the property by the prior owners, and I don't think it's fair to the applicant that they be saddled with the sins of their predecessors. Anybody that's planning on building a barn this large in this day and age on this site is going to spend a lot of money doing it, and it's not going to fall down anytime soon. So I don't give a lot of credence to that concern. On the other hand, the use of the driveway has been a problem, and I can understand why the abutter wants to keep an eye on how things are going.
Then we're getting into the, we're not here to enforce the easement and enforce the deed and police Jason and how they handle it.
Right.
But obviously it sounds like it probably wasn't handled very well over the years, but we have to treat this as separate from all of that and whether it stands on its own merits. Someone like to make a motion? Gonna have to do it eventually.
It's your turn.
I mean, I think the other reality is that probably if this barn never caved in, it would be a much easier decision just to allow them to rebuild it. If we visually could see the structure there, and we've gone down that.
Something more than some right. Rocks on the ground.
We've gone down that road plenty of times. So again, that's another thing that the owner doesn't have to their advantage.
Right.
What was there not too long ago is now gone, though it was there 100 years.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion for discussion purposes at any rate. I'll make a motion that to deny the request.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
All right. Your motion, please.
Yeah. I mean, I think we've had a lot of discussion about this. This is a tough one. I think, again, there's a lot there that the applicant has requested that I think under and some other circumstances could be okay. I think where it kind of falls down in my mind is, the hardship criteria in terms of they're trying to say, okay, well, this easement really sort of allows us this extra distance, and to a certain extent it does, but it is still somebody else's property. It's not truly in your property. It is somebody else's. They have some certain rights associated with the use and enjoyment of that property. Admittedly, they've given up some of those rights in terms of your ability to pass over that space with up to and including farm animals apparently. So what's the real drivers for putting this up near the property line? I think the drivers that we've heard are there's an existing foundation and there's an existing hole. You know, again, looking at the foundation and the fact we're not in a historic district, I'm looking at it, I don't see a lot there that I would want to count on, or really from an economic standpoint, want to be able to go and say that it's economically worth reusing. My personal guess is by the time the applicant was all said and done, there would be very little, if anything, left of the original foundation. So then pushing it back to the 10-foot line, which is what the ordinance says, you know, now you're talking about potential fill issues. It does look like it's on a hill. So, you know, maybe if you had to, you probably need, I would agree, you probably need some fill to be able to put in on the backside where the hill's going down and then in sort of the hole where that was created by the barn. But again, those sorts of things, fill is not that incredibly expensive that it would be an extremely tough burden on the property owner. I thought about, you know, do we want to, you know, split the difference and, you know, and try and say, you know, well, you can't have 3 feet, but you can have 5 feet. Well, I'm really not sure that there's any real benefit to that either. In terms of, you know, it still has the concern of the abutting property owner really hasn't been met and that there is still some encroachment. It still requires the property owner to demolish the foundation and, you know, do this fill thing. So 5 feet, 10 feet, I don't see where there's a huge difference for the property owner. And then the other drivers I'm trying to take a look at is, you know, sometimes when we see positioning of barns or garages, we're looking at, you know, there's some unique aspect to the property where there's a driveway that's been lined up because it's a very small property, or it's the most convenient location because it's going to impinge upon neighboring buildings in some way, shape, or manner. Really, this is a whole wide open area at the back of the abutter's property. It's not, you know, there's nothing else that's back there. To me, if you had to move it over 7 feet, it doesn't present a huge imposition on the property owner. And I think Mr. Lemay had a good point too, in that if there is something that the property owner goes back and sees that says, man, this is going to be super expensive to go and do this, they haven't presented to us anything that would indicate that. But if they did say, you know, we found a huge ledge or something in there that would add an enormous amount of expense and it doesn't make sense to do it, could we do it at some other distance, maybe back to the 3 feet or maybe 5 feet or something along those lines, I would say that that would be sufficient, that a Fisher v. Dover argument wouldn't come into play here, and that I would certainly be happy to rehear their case at that point in time and perhaps, you know, ultimately come up with a different decision that would reflect that. But I think under those, I think it falls down under the hardship and to a certain extent the substantial justice of criteria of, you know, their needs and desires to be able to place the barn that much closer, weighed against the competing interests of abutters to, you know, have some distance relative to their property. And I think with those, it's not meeting those two criteria and therefore should be denied.
Right. Your second, please.
I'll just add that it's curious that we're in a position of balancing a very small hardship that would be building this 7 feet away when you're probably going to have to rebuild the foundation anyway against a very small encroachment on the part of the abutter. So it's like we've got these two de minimis issues that really become the crux of the matter, I think. But I don't think, barring some substantiated actual hardship in moving it and building it a little, you know, a few feet over, I don't think we have justification to grant the variance.
Okay. Any further comments from the board? Mr. Parrott?
I would just add that I guess I would have liked to have heard a hard factual argument as to why it can't be built over a little further. That was the basis of my question, to go at why is it where it is? There's got to be some reason other than bringing big in supplies, and you've taken supplies a whole long way to get them to this point, so another few feet isn't going to make any difference. And I guess we didn't hear that, but as has been suggested, if some good engineering work proves otherwise, then there could be many reasons. I'd certainly be willing to rehear it as well. So it's certainly a close call.
Okay.
I think I will support the motion.
Right. I mean, I felt the applicant made a I won't say a strong case, but he did make a case for fill and whatnot. I don't have enough of lay of the land here to have a sense of how much fill are we talking about, or, you know, if you end up tearing down the foundation anyways, there's your fill, but good old New Hampshire rock. So I don't think, you know, again, there was a strong case of why they can't move it. Because one thing I'm looking at is the whole, when you get to a setback variance, what we're dealing really with is light and air and encroachment on an abutter. And the abutter in opposition, you know, their rear property line comes into the halfway point of the barn, and then the other half of the barn encroaches on the Chase home. It's a good long distance away. And the fact for, you know, 100 years there was a barn there, it was a structure there, so it's, I don't feel we're adding this kind of shock value where all of a sudden, how did this ever get here? Well, something's been there for 100 years, and it's been rebuilt in the same footprint. I don't almost feel like we're imposing this huge hardship that no one ever saw coming. You know, if these folks had bought it 10 years ago, maybe they would have renovated it before it collapsed, and you know, everyone would be on their way. So again, we are splitting hairs between 3 feet and 10 feet here, right? We're talking about moving it 7 feet, but again, when I look at the whole issue of light and air and setbacks, I'm like, I'm not sure where that adverse impact is and what the change in essential character of the neighborhood. Its character will be the same if it stays the same. And so, again, it's not that cut and dry and easy, but it's...
But the question is whether it's justified, not whether it does any harm. And I'm fishing for justification for
not being able to meet the requirements.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Everyone had their piece. Everyone ready to take a vote? All right. The motion is to deny. Mr. Moretti?
Yes.
Mr. Rayoun?
Yes.
Mr. Durbin?
No.
Mr. Parrott?
Yes.
Mr. LeMay?
Yes.
Mr. Mulligan?
No.
The chair votes no. We have the petition has been denied 4-3. All right. One thing I'll just bring up to the board, there's been some discussion going on amongst all the city boards about training and seminars and conferences, and I think that's all well and good, but I know personally it's hard for me to go to Concord on a Saturday or whatever.
You'd have loved it, trust me.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, I have been to one, and
the lunch was very good.
Some of it was helpful. But there is talk about bringing someone to Portsmouth.
I was going to say.
And maybe they sit down with our board. And I was saying, well, instead of just having the standard presentation, maybe we could have a brief presentation. Because the one I went to, they went through the 5 criteria and whatnot. And I think we would have got glazed over pretty quickly. But my idea was someone come in, present maybe a quick presentation, and then just have a Q&A where we just go at them with issues that arise for us. The conflict of interest or Fisher versus Dover, or things sometimes we struggle with,
HTC.
And then just have an expert we can just throw stuff at and get some of our answers. So that's what we're kicking around now, and so we may be sending out an email for people to just generate some questions, and then maybe what we could do is pull together 10, 15 questions that we could, a presenter could be prepared for, does his spiel, and then we can, I think it'd be more productive if we actually address the issues that we grapple with,
yeah,
as opposed to just getting this kind of blanket presentation.
Yeah,
so that's
perhaps
that's
some a segment on whatever's been actually new in the past.
Yeah.
2 years or
yep,
whatever.
Latest court cases or things like that.
Yeah.
Yep. So that's in the pipeline. I'll keep everyone posted. Also, congratulate Mr. Moretti on being appointed last night to a full-time board member.
All right.
Thank you. Earned it the hard way. And then, so we do have an opening if you want to get the word out. Slim pickings in the application part.
I don't think it's the word I want to get out.
Yeah. All right, so does anyone like to make a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned.
No objections will be taken for the next.